Well, it was the State of the Union address. Was anything unusual? Not really. But the president laid out an ambitious agenda for America. And he laid, in the State of the Union, he had what he wanted to see done for America. And the reaction was predictable.
Pat, the president's plan covers the economy, government spending, gun control, and a lot more. John Jessup has this look at his speech and what people are saying about it.
Emboldened by a second term in the Oval Office, President Obama declared a stronger America than 4 years ago.
Together, we have cleared away the rubble of crisis. And we can say with renewed confidence that the state of our union is stronger.
And to keep it on that path, he argued for a balanced approach to fend off the sequester, automatic spending cuts to the military and domestic programs set to kick in next month. Both parties are talking about them as if they're a done deal.
I think we have to implement them to show the American people we mean business about spending cuts.
You will see furloughs. People will be hurt, both in the public sector and in the private sector that has contracts with the government of the United States to carry out research and development.
He also pressed Congress to create a fair, more competitive America. That would include raising the federal minimum wage to $9 an hour, investing in early childhood education, and creating a jobs program to fix the country's collapsing infrastructure. Ideas criticized by Florida Senator Marco Rubio in the official Republican response.
His solution to virtually every problem we face is for Washington to tax more, borrow more, and spend more.
Mr. Obama prodded Congress on climate control and continued his call for comprehensive immigration reform, an area where Democrats say they're finding more willing Republican partners.
I think they get it, and they get it only because the Hispanics have made them get it. They're growing numbers, all going to the polls to vote for a Democrat.
On national security, the president announced 34,000 U.S. troops will return from Afghanistan in the next year. And by the end of 2014, he says the war in Afghanistan will be over. He pledged to work closer with Congress in pursuing terrorists and addressing nuclear threats like Iran and North Korea. The president also took the opportunity to focus on the fight for gun control, naming victims from recent shootings who were in the chamber.
They deserve a vote. Gabby Giffords deserves a vote. The families of Newtown deserve a vote. The families of Aurora deserve a vote. The families of Oak Creek and Tucson and Blacksburg and the countless other communities ripped open by gun violence, they deserve a simple vote.
One Republican congressman said the president's focus to prevent violence on children is too narrow, saying he fails to remember lives lost to abortion.
When he talks about 1,000 children that will never have birthdays in the last month or so, he leaves out the 4,000 children that died today in abortion clinics that will also never have birthdays.
While Republicans will create roadblocks for the president's second term agenda, the president faces another challenge, time, which is not on his side. Political scientists agree second term presidents usually have between a year to a year and a half before attention shifts to the next wave of elections, which means President Obama has little time to pull off any major legislative feats. John Jessup, CBN News, Capitol Hill.
Thanks, John. CBN News had a special interview this morning with the man who gave the Republican response, Florida Senator Marco Rubio. Lee Webb has that story from the CBN newsroom. Lee?
Pat, there was much anticipation surrounding Marco Rubio's rebuttal to the president. He is a rising star in the party, and some think he could be the GOP's presidential nominee in 2016. But the Twitter universe is all abuzz over this part in his speech. He bent down off camera, as you could tell there, and grabbed a sip of water. It did look a bit awkward. Rubio is having fun with it, though. And he talked about his speech and the future of the Republican Party with CBN's David Brody on Capitol Hill.
What is one way that you believe that your address, if you will, contrasted the president's?
Well, I believe the free enterprise system is the source of our middle class prosperity, and the president thinks the source of our middle class prosperity is the government. In fact, it's a pretty far departure from where most presidents have been. As I said last night, Democrats and Republicans, from John F. Kennedy to Ronald Reagan, have understood that our free enterprise system is the source of our middle class prosperity.
The president thinks that our free enterprise system is the source of our problems.
This free enterprise system that you've talked about, I mean, Mitt Romney talked about this for a couple of years in the campaign trail, or at least the last year of the campaign trail. Why would it be different here specifically in terms of the future? I mean, it didn't necessarily translate to victory in 2012.
Well, we have to keep talking about it until hopefully the people make the connection that don't agree with us right now. I think the way you do it is you outline people's lives. You talk about how it's impacting them.
I am curious about deficit reduction, because when the president talked about deficit reduction, a lot of folks probably just, laughed at some point. I'm just wondering, do you believe he's being deceitful on that? Or do you believe he's being real honest when it comes to wanting to reduce the deficit?
He doesn't understand what the danger in the deficit is. I mean, first of all, the deficit is how much we owe every year. We have a national debt that's already $16.5 trillion. That figure needs to be brought down or stabilized in comparison to our overall budget. And the only solution to that problem, there is no other solution, is the combination of rapid economic growth and stabilizing our spending in future years. That's the only, you have to do both. And there is no tax increase that will help us do that.
Talk to me about the Republican Party and the future of the GOP. What is the biggest challenge right now for the Republican Party?
Well, I mean, the challenge is to continue to apply our principles to the challenges of the 21st century. And the challenges of the 21st century in some ways are different than the challenges of the 20th century. The reality is that we do have societal and moral decay in our country, as I outlined last night, and many of the answers to those problems don't lie in our politicians. They lie in our faith, and they lie in our families. And I think it's okay for government officials to say, one of the leading causes of poverty has nothing to do with government. It has to do with broken families.
All right, so Time Magazine, the Republican savior, does that come with a Superman cape? Have you tried that out?
Well, as last night, as you saw on the broadcast, God has a funny way of reminding us we're human. When I had to take a drink of water, and everybody's having a lot of fun with that. There are no saviors in politics. There's only one savior, as I tweeted out, and it isn't me.
It's a hashtag, too.
It's a hashtag, is it? Yeah, is that right? Yeah,
Jesus.
It's a hashtag, Jesus, yeah. But, the bottom line is, look, I'm a public servant. There have been other people in the past that have been talked about the way I'm talked about now, and there'll be other people talked about me in the future, maybe as early as today. So my job is to come up here, do the best I can on behalf of the state of Florida and the United States of America. The rest takes care of itself.
Florida Senator Marco Rubio. Pat, he's comfortable on his feet.
Amazingly so. He is very poised for a person of his age, I mean, for any age, and he's extremely articulate, and he's got the right stuff. I think they're already setting it up. It'll probably be Rubio versus Hillary Clinton. We'll see how that one plays out. His thing right now, Lee, is immigration, and he wants evangelicals to support his immigration program. So I think it's very wise, the son of Cuban immigrants, to talk about how to fix this immigration problem, because we need to do it. He's Hispanic, and he's the best spokesperson the Republicans could have to address this issue, which is so very, very important. Lee.
Kentucky Senator Rand Paul delivered a Tea Party response to the president's address last night. He called for a balanced budget with limits on taxes and spending, and he took a swipe at the president over gun control.
We cannot and will not allow any president to act as if he were a king. We will not let any president use executive orders to impinge on the Second Amendment.
And Paul also says Republicans need to welcome immigrants to America. Chuck Hagel squeaked through a Senate committee vote and is one step closer now to becoming the next Secretary of Defense. But Republicans will try to postpone a final vote to confirm Hagel in the full Senate. The Armed Services Committee voted 14-11 along party lines to send Hagel's nomination to the floor. Republicans criticized Hagel's past stands on Israel, Iran, Iraq, and nuclear weapons. They also questioned whether he received payments from radical groups. Republican Senator John McCain defended Hagel as an honorable man, but in the end voted against his nomination. Democrats say they have enough votes, however, to confirm Hagel in the full Senate. Pat?
Well, there's some question of whether there's 60 votes, and that's what they're talking about now. If they don't have 60 votes, of course, that would be enough to invoke cloture. The thing that they're not talking about, though, is that this is the guy that's got to approve multi-million dollar defense contracts. The design of an F-35 fighter, the design of an aircraft carrier, the deployment of huge flotillas of ships into various oceans. I mean, it's an incredibly complex job, and he doesn't have the experience for it. And all they talk about is, well, what speech did he make about Israel? Well, big deal. How can he run this monstrous agency and do it efficiently? And nobody, and I mean nobody up there, is talking about the most important qualification. How can he, with no experience, run one of the biggest corporations in the world? And the answer is, they don't know, and he probably can't do it. You know, you don't learn on the job in a troubled world like we have. Lee?
Pat, the French National Assembly voted overwhelmingly to legalize same-sex marriage and adoption by homosexual couples. The measure now heads to the French Senate, where it's expected to pass. Hundreds of protesters gathered outside the National Assembly, however, Tuesday to protest the bill. But polls indicate that most French citizens support legalizing gay marriage. About a dozen European nations now allow same-sex marriage. Well, taking folic acid before and during pregnancy is linked to a lower risk of autism. A new study published in the Journal of the American Medical Association found that mothers who took folic acid had a 40% reduced risk of giving birth to a child with autism. Folic acid supplements are already recommended for mothers-to-be as a way to prevent other birth defects like spina bifida. About one in 88 children in the U.S. is diagnosed with an autism-related condition, Pat.
Well, and that's also recommended for stroke, heart attacks, things like this. It's a part of the vitamin B complex and very important. And, you know, if you don't take vitamins, you're deficient. It used to be a time that we had this rich soil, and we had organic fertilizers, and so what grew out of that soil had all these nutrients. Now the soil is depleted of nutrients, and they're grown in rather hothouse conditions, and you don't get the same nutritional value out of the vegetables and the food you eat, so you need to supplement. It's just that simple, and folic acid, vitamin B complex is very important. Do you take your vitamins, dear?
I'm not consistent. I have to admit, I have to say the truth. I have them, I just don't take them as regularly.
I want you to take them.
I know, I'm
going to
work on
that. I want you to be healthy. We need to have you around for a long, long time.
Good answer.
Rick Warren says religious freedom is under attack in America. The pastor of California's Saddleback Church spoke at a forum on religious liberty at Georgetown University. He called the birth control mandate in Obamacare a direct attack on religious liberty, and he predicted the U.S. Supreme Court will strike it down. Pastor Warren also said that if pastors are barred from praying at public functions because of their opposition to homosexuality, then 99% of American pastors will be excluded. A federal judge has struck down an Arizona law that blocked Medicare funding of Planned Parenthood abortion clinics. Judge Neil Wake said the law banned the use of Medicare dollars for general health services provided at abortion clinics. He ruled that it violates a patient's rights to use the funding wherever they choose. But Marjorie Dannenfelser of the Susan B. Anthony List stated, Judge Wake's ruling thwarts the will of Arizona taxpayers to stop funding big abortion businesses such as Planned Parenthood. As a result, funds will be reduced for what agencies that provide whole women's health care. A federal appeals court recently struck down a similar law in Indiana. You can always get the latest news from CBN by going to our website at cbnnews.com.